Good afternoon, and welcome to the first in a series of video guides I'll be making for the disciplines I play in Star Wars The Old Republic. First up is the Serenity Shadow, which is one of my favorite DPS specs, and is incredibly powerful right now in both PvE and PvP. BioWare has announced that they'll be nerfing the class in a couple of weeks by reducing our self-heals and the range in some of our abilities, but even so, I imagine Serenity will still be a top-tier choice in PvP and PvE for some time to come. So this is my max level shadow, Leovara, whom I'm sure you've seen me using in a lot of my other videos, and today I'll be using her to show you the gear, utilities, moves, and rotation that you should be using as Serenity, along with some tips and tricks that I've picked up along the way. If you want to fast forward to any specific section of the guide, you can do that by clicking on any of the links down in the description below. So I'll start off with a brief overview, just for anyone who is completely unfamiliar with the class. Serenity is one of two DPS specs that's available to Shadows, along with Infiltration, and of course we can also tank using Kinetic Combat. Shadows are a melee class, so we have a lot of 4-meter range abilities, but we actually have a decent number of 10-meter and, at least for now, a couple 30-meter ranged abilities as well. We're a light armor class, but we have a number of defensive cooldowns that help us stay alive, and we offer a really good amount of group utility, especially in PvP. Infiltration is definitely viable as an alternative to Serenity, but considering the position that we're in right now, Serenity has pretty much become the go-to choice for most players, and with good reason. So, we're going to start off by going over the damaging abilities you'll tend to use as a Serenity Shadow, but before we do, you want to make sure that you're always in Force Technique, that your class buffs are active, and that you're using a stim, preferably an Advanced Anodyne Resolve stim, which is the best willpower stim currently available in the game. Force Technique gives all of our melee attacks a 50% chance to do a bit of extra energy damage, which is a nice little passive boost that you won't really have to think about all that much. Now, Serenity is a DOT spec, and DOT, for those of you unfamiliar with the term, stands for Damage Over Time, and refers to any ability that, instead of doing all of its damage up front, instead puts a debuff on the target, which will continue to damage them every few seconds until it wears off. Sometimes these are referred to as periodic damaging abilities by the in-game tooltips. Serenity Shadows have two main dot attacks, Sever Force and Force Breach, each of which lasts for 18 seconds, has no cooldown, and costs 20 force to activate. Force Breach is an ability that's used by all Shadows, and its effect changes depending on which technique you're in, so it's only a dot while you are in Force Technique. Sever Force you'll get at level 26 as part of the discipline, and it has the added benefit of rooting the target for 2 seconds as soon as it's applied. This rooting effect can only take place up to once every 9 seconds, and of course any enemy with the boss melee debuff cannot be rooted at all, so it won't affect any boss in an operation or flashpoint. In addition, both of these dots heal us for 25% of the damage they do, although that might be getting reduced to 10% in an upcoming patch. Vanquish is our third major ability, and it does a large amount of damage up front and also puts a dot on the opponent, which will last for 6 seconds. By default, it's a 2-second cast, as you just saw, but there's a proc that will allow us to make it activate instantaneously, and we'll talk about that a little later on. Vanquish is basically the enhanced version of Mindcrush, which is what you'll be using in its place up to level 57, but Vanquish has the added benefit of making its target take 5% more damage from force attacks from all sources for 45 seconds, so it's especially nice to have in a group setting. Next up is Force Imbalance, which is really the linchpin of this discipline. Force Imbalance is an AoE that, like Vanquish, has a 30-meter range, although BioWare might be lowering that down to 10 meters in upcoming patch as well. It'll affect up to 8 enemies within 8 meters of the primary target, and will heal you for 10% of all the damage it does. It'll also gain a number of other benefits from the discipline, but we'll talk about those later on as well. Our last two ranged abilities you won't be using nearly as often as those four. The first of them is Telekinetic Throw. It's a 3-second channel with a 10-meter range. Pretty much the only time you might want to use Telekinetic Throw is in PvP, if you're facing an opponent that has a sliver of health left, or if you have a capper who is out of range of all your other abilities. In that case, if you have Force Potency active, and that's one of our offensive cooldowns, you can pop that to temporarily give Telekinetic Throw a 30-meter range, and that'll allow you to finish off the opponent or to stop the capper. Project is our last ranged ability. It has a 10-meter range, costs 40 force, which is kind of a lot, and does a pretty mediocre amount of damage, so you only want to use that if you're trying to finish off an opponent and all of your other ranged abilities are off cooldown. As far as melee abilities go, there are really only 5 we're ever going to use, and those are Serenity Strike, Spitting Strike, Saber Strike, Double Strike, and Whirling Blow. Of these, Whirling Blow is the only AoE, and it'll hit up to 8 targets within 5 meters. It does about half the damage that Double Strike does, so you only want to really use it when there are 3 or more opponents within range. Serenity Strike is our newest ability. It was added in 3.0, and it does a pretty good amount of damage, and more importantly, it'll heal you for 50% of the damage it does. At level 52 and above, it'll instead heal you for 100% of the damage it does due to one of the passives from the discipline. Spinning Strike is our most powerful ability, but it's also our execute, which means it can only be used against targets with less than 30% of our health. There is, however, a proc that you get from the discipline, which will allow us to use it at other times as well. Double Strike is our primary filler ability, and that's what you use when nothing else is available. It does a solid amount of damage and costs 22 force. And then last and least, you have Saber Strike, which is pretty much what you're going to use in place of Double Strike whenever you start to get a little low on force. Next up, we're going to go over the offensive cooldowns of the Serenity Shadow, of which we have three: Force Potency, Battle Readiness, and of course our Attack Adrenal. All of these are off the global cooldown, which means you can use them and then use another ability directly afterwards without having to wait the normal 1.5 seconds in between. Force Potency we've talked about a little already in that it does increase the range of telekinetic throw to 30 meters. However, as you're almost never going to use this ability, that's the least useful of its effects. Normally, it will give you two charges of Force Potency, which increase the critical chance of your next force abilities by 60%. You can also select a utility, which will make it three charges. And by force attacks, that pretty much just means force imbalance and vanquish. When possible, you want to try to use up those charges on force imbalance because it does more damage than the initial hit of vanquish will. But because force imbalance is a 15-second cooldown and this attack's potency only lasts for 20 seconds, you're going to have to use them in the best-case scenario on two force imbalances and one vanquish. Next up is Battle Readiness, which has a number of effects and can be used as both an offensive and a defensive cooldown. I tend to use it more as an offensive cooldown in PvE and a defensive cooldown in PvP. Offensively, it'll increase the chance of your Force Technique's effect trigger by 25% and will increase the damage it does by 50%. Additionally, Battle Readiness will heal you for 15% right off the bat and will heal you for even more every time the effect of your Force Technique is triggered during that 15 seconds, so you ideally want to pop it right before using a lot of melee abilities. Last but certainly not least is our Attack Adrenal, which of course every class gets, and that will increase our power by 750 points for 15 seconds, so you want to try to use that in alignment with the other two offensive cooldowns in PvE whenever possible. You also want to try to align them with the class buffs from other classes in order to get the most benefit out of all of them. Serenity Shadows also have a number of defensive cooldowns, and these will help you stay alive in PvE and in PvP. One of our best defensive cooldowns is Resilience, and the cooldown on that is 1 minute. It lasts 3 seconds, or 5 seconds if you have the appropriate utility. Resilience removes all hostile effects, in other words, enemy dots, from you, and will make you immune to all force and tech attacks, aka yellow damage, for the duration. It's best to use Resilience when you have a lot of enemy dots on you and you need to get rid of them, or when you're about to be bursted by a tech or force heavy class, such as a Vanguard or a Sage. On the flip side, when it comes to white damage, we have Deflection, which has a cooldown of 2 minutes, but lasts for 12 seconds. And during those 12 seconds, our defense against melee and ranged attacks is increased by 50%. So it's best to use Deflection when you're being attacked by a lot of white damage heavy classes like Guardians or Sentinels. You can also select a utility, which will make you completely immune to stuns, but not knockbacks or roots, whenever Deflection is active. And if you have that utility, it's often best to use Deflection offensively. In other words, when you're about to burst down a low health opponent and can't afford to be stunned. In addition to those two abilities, we also have our AoE taunt, Mass Mind Control. In PvP, you'll primarily use this to reduce the amount of outgoing damage enemies are doing to your teammates, and in PvE, you'll primarily use this as a detaunt to reduce the amount of threat you have on the boss or on the adds. However, it does also reduce all incoming damage to you by 30% for 6 seconds, thanks to part of our discipline, so if you have it available, feel free to use it as a defensive cooldown as well. As I mentioned before, we have a lot of passive self-healing just from our dots, but don't forget that you can also use Serenity Strike, Force Imbalance, or Battle Readiness for their healing component. Phase Walk is more of a utility ability than a defensive cooldown, but it can remove you from the fighting and away from whatever is attacking you. And then as a measure of last resort, you also have Force Cloak, which will take you out of combat and into stealth, making it impossible for your opponent to target you. Two warnings with Force Cloak, though. Remember, if you have any enemy dots ticking on you, as soon as they tick, they will break you out of stealth, and if you have any of your dots on your opponents, as soon as they tick, they will put you back into combat. So if you're trying to use this to break combat and stealth res in PvE, or use your out-of-combat heal in PvP, make sure there are no dots ticking on you, which is one good use of resilience, and make sure that none of your dots are still ticking on your opponents. In addition to those abilities, we of course have our items, which include our adrenals, our med packs, and our grenades. Wards and Adrenals will reduce all the incoming damage by 15% for 15 seconds, so it's good to use that when you're about to be heavily focused by the enemy team. Whereas in medpacks, we'll heal you for 35% of your maximum health, whereas PvE medpacks do a set amount of healing along with a small heal over time component. And you want to use these whenever you're low on health and whenever your healers, if you have one, are otherwise occupied. Lastly are the grenades, and grenades aren't as useful for Serenity Shadows as they are for some other classes, but you should carry them with you at all times anyway. You want to use a seismic grenade, and the higher quality the better, as these will do a little bit of damage and stun your opponents for up to 5 seconds. These stuns do break on damage, and because you'll normally have your dots ticking on your opponents, you'll have to be very careful about when and how you use them. The best time to use a grenade is when you see a few enemies attacking one of your teammates, and you can catch them with the grenade while they don't have any dots on them yet. That being said, even if the stun from the grenade breaks fairly quickly, those few seconds provided by the initial knockdown is sometimes all it takes for your healer to get back on their feet and to get things back under control. You can also try using the grenade offensively as a way to stun the enemy healer and or tank when you're trying to focus down an unguarded target, but again, that can be hard to pull off due to the dots you'll likely have ticking on most of your opponents, so that's one of the few downsides to playing a Serenity Shadow. Grenades rarely have any use in PvE, however there are a few notable exceptions, such as the Revenant Commander's Fight in Temple of Sacrifice, or the lower difficulties of Grobthok in Dread Fortress. We also have quite a few utility abilities, which is what I call any ability that does not primarily deal damage, mitigate damage, or heal. Probably the most iconic of these for a shadow is Stealth, which will make us invisible. See, you can't see me, haha. In PvE, you won't be using stealth very much as Serenity, but you will be using it quite often in PvP, and in fact, as soon as you get inside an arena, or as soon as you get a cube pop for ranked, be sure to go into stealth immediately, so that your opponents can't target you or put a target marker on you. Note that when you're in stealth, you'll be moving at 85% of your normal movement speed, so you don't want to be in stealth when you're trying to get to a node quickly, for example. But on the whole, whenever you're out of combat and it proves advantageous, try to remain in stealth as much as possible, so that you can get the jump on your opponents instead of having them get the jump on you. Speaking of movement, we have Force Speed, which is a really great ability. There are utilities that will reduce the cooldown or increase the duration, but by default it will increase your movement speed by 150%. In other words, make you move 2.5 times as quickly for 2 seconds. So if you need to get somewhere fast, I'm running, and bam, Force Speed, zoom, 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 zoom. So much fun. You can choose a utility that will make you immune to all roots and slows whenever you have Force Speed active, which is really nice for Serenity Shadows because we are primarily a melee class. And it's useful to stay in range of your opponents so you can keep using all those nice lightsaber abilities on them. Do note that Force Speed can be used while stealth, so for example, here I am in stealth, going very slow, and bam! As soon as I had Force Speed, I gained that nice 150% movement speed increase. There are also two abilities which you can only use while in stealth, and those are Mind Maze and Blackout. Mind Maze is a CC, which stands for Crowd Control, and that means it'll stun an opponent for 8 seconds and break if that opponent takes any damage at all. It does cost half your force to use, and it can only be applied to one opponent at a time, so use it carefully. And more importantly, it can only be used if both you and your opponent are out of combat, so be sure your teammates stay out of range if you're trying to run in first to mind-maze someone, and be careful not to get caught in Stealth Scan or another AoE as you approach your target. A target that is under the effect of mind-maze is often said to be mezzed or sapped, which I believe are terms from World of Warcraft, so if someone tells you to mezz or sap an opponent, that's what they're talking about. You also get Blackout, which increases your stealth level by 15 points for 8 seconds. So in arenas, a typical strategy is to move in towards an enemy team before the fight begins, come up behind them, hit Blackout so they're less likely to detect you, and then Mind Maze one of them. That way you can open one of their teammates, and one of them is going to be stunned for the first 8 seconds of the fight. Obviously, you want to be very careful using Force Imbalance, as that could easily break the CC. And of course, your target can always use their CC Breaker if they really want to burn it right off the bat to get rid of the stun. If you're the last member of your team alive, or if you're trying to solo cap in regs, you can also use Force Cloak to get back into stealth, and then Mind Maze one of your opponents then. And then I'll give you a free 8 seconds to do pretty much whatever you want. This can also be a good strategy if you're the only remaining member of your team, or if the only remaining members of your team are stealthers, and you can coordinate your out-of-stealth abilities to get out of combat at the same time. In addition to Mind Maze, we also have two other stuns, Force Stun and Force Lift. Force Stun is our hard stun, which means it will stun the opponent for 4 seconds and will not break on damage. The only targets you cannot stun are enemies with the boss immunity buff or enemy players who have max resolve, which is commonly known as white barring, because when they're max resolved, their resolve bar, you can see mine here, it's empty because I'm not in PvP, will turn totally white and make them completely immune to stuns. Force Stun can be used once every 60 seconds, and that cooldown can be reduced by Alacrity and by one of our utilities. It does do a tiny bit of damage, but that's not really all that significant. Force Stun is primarily used to stun an enemy healer when you're about to burst them down or burst down one of their teammates. It can also be used on an enemy tank if your team is about to focus an unguarded target and you don't want them to swap guard during the next 4 seconds. And it can also be used if one of your teammates is being attacked by somebody, and you need to give them a bit of breathing room by stunning their attacker momentarily. It can even be used on somebody attacking you for that exact same purpose. Then we have our normal long-term CC, Force Lift, which, like Mind Maze, incapacitates the target for 8 seconds and breaks on damage taken, so be careful not to use it against any targets that have dots ticking on them. If you're using it near the start of the fight in an arena, it's a good idea to let your team know who you'll be trying to Force Lift, so that if they're smart, they'll be careful not to break it. Unlike Mind Maze, Force Lift can be used in combat. It does not require stealth and costs very little force, and by default it has a cast time of 2 seconds. There is also a utility which will make Force Lift instant and make it stun an opponent for 2 additional seconds if it's broken due to damage. Naturally, the second stun also respects resolve, so if the lift itself white bars your target, and then the lift breaks from damage, the bonus stun won't take effect. Speaking of max resolve, things you can do to max resolve people includes roots, such as from Sever Force, and slows from Force Slow. So even if you're chasing somebody who's white barred, feel free to use those abilities on them to make sure you can get back in melee range, especially if Force Speed is on cooldown. Other than that, if you're trying to get enemies away from one of your teammates, you can always use Force Wave, which does a bit of damage and knocks your opponents back. Now, as a melee class, Force Wave is a little less useful for Shadows than it is for Sages, but if you're trying to peel for a teammate, or if you're in an arena and you see someone standing on a ledge, don't be afraid to use it to knock them off, because the time they take running back up there is time they're not spending DPSing or healing. You can also use Force Wave as an additional interrupt if you can catch your opponent mid-cast or mid-channel, but of course you can only do that if they're not white barred. Speaking of interrupts, we also have Mind Snap, which is our standard interrupt. It's on an 18-second cooldown, which can be reduced to 16 seconds with one of our utilities. It has a 10-meter range, and just like all interrupts, it'll prevent the target from using that same ability again for the next 4 seconds. We also have Force of Will, which is our standard CC break. It's on a 2-minute cooldown, which can be reduced to a minute 30 with the appropriate utility. Force of Will is a really important ability in PvP, and it has some situational uses in PvE. There are a few boss fights where you might get stunned. Some good examples are Torque or the final boss fight of Ravagers, but on the whole, you're going to be using it a lot more often in war zones or in arenas than you will in PvE. In arenas, I like to say Force of Will as much as possible because there are a few very specific situations where you're going to need it, and if you just use it every time you're stunned or even every time you're white barred, then you might not have it up when you really need it. I tend to use it either when my health is low and the tanker healer is overwhelmed, so that I can use it to break my stun and pop a defensive cooldown to keep myself alive, or I can use it if I'm going in for the kill on an enemy and one of their teammates tries to peel by stunning me, so I can use it to break the stun and get in a couple extra hits to finish off my opponent. On the whole though, you'll want to save Force of Will as much as humanly possible and only use it when you're absolutely sure that it's worth the risk. In regular war zones, just like in arenas, you want to save it as much as possible. The best time to use it is when your opponent is trying to cap either a door in Voidstar or a node in Alderaan or Hypergates, because if you use it earlier in the match and you're trying to interrupt an opponent while they're capping and then you get stunned, then there's nothing you can do but stand there dumbfounded and watch them cap the node. So this brings us to our taunts, and we have two taunts. Mind Control, which is our single target taunt, and Mass Mind Control, which, as the name suggests, is our AoE taunt. Mind Control has to have a target to use and has a 30-meter range. Mass Mind Control will simply affect anyone within a 15-meter range of wherever you're standing when you use it. In PvE, you will very rarely use your single target taunt as a DPS. There are situations where you may need to use it, but unless you're absolutely sure you're in one of those situations, or unless it's part of a strategy you discussed beforehand, try to never use it, as it can really screw up what the tanks are doing if you pull aggro unexpectedly. Mass Mind Control works differently while in a DPS stance than it does in combat technique, which is the tank stance. So instead of increasing threat, it'll actually work as a detaunt, lowering your threat on any target that it hits. So if you have a bunch of adds attacking you, or even the boss attacking you, hit Mass Mind Control right away, and hopefully that will reduce your threat to the point that they stop attacking you and go back to one of the tanks. You can also use it preemptively, or as a defensive cooldown, and use it to reduce threat before you overtake one of the tanks, if your tanks are having a little bit of trouble maintaining threat. In PvP, you cannot overestimate how useful a taunt is. It drives me nuts whenever I see a class that has taunts who just refuses to use them. You want to be spamming these pretty much off cooldown. Anytime you're standing near a group of enemies, use Mass Mind Control. Anytime you see an enemy attacking one of your teammates, use Mind Control on them. Remember that they have quite a bit of range, and remember that you don't want to use Mind Control on somebody who's attacking you, because it doesn't reduce the damage that they do to you, only the damage they do to your teammates. Use these often, use these off cooldown, you'll get good numbers on the scoreboard, you'll get medals, your healers and teammates will love you, and remember that every point of damage taken away from an enemy team is just as valuable as every point of damage from your team that you're dishing out, so there's no reason you should ever have a big goose egg where it says protection on the scoreboard. Last, but certainly not least, is Phase Walk, which is an ability you'll get at level 51. It was added in 2.0, and after a recent bug fix, it now works the same way for Shadows as it does for Assassins. Phase Walk has a really short cast time, only 0.5 seconds, but you do have to be standing still to use it, and you can also use it while you are in stealth. So what it does is you lay down Phase Walk, and then you can move anywhere within 60 meters of your Phase Walk location, and when you activate it a second time, you're instantly ported right back to where you were when you laid down your phase walk. So as you can imagine, this is really useful in PvP and PvE, but especially in PvP. Phase walk has a utility available, which is called Shadow Shelter, which will increase your overall healing received, as well as increase the healing done by any healer standing close to your phase walk location. So that's something you're probably going to want to take in PvE in order to benefit your healers. You can also use phase walk in operations as a way to escape from a boss AoE or a Conal attack. So a good example of that is in the Cortani fight, where her turrets have those giant yellow conals. If for whatever reason you get stuck in one of them and you can't get out normally, you can pop phase walk and you'll be right back out of it where your location was right away. Phase walk is also really useful in the Storm Squadron fight, also known as the Walkers in Temple of Sacrifice, because if you're the barrel carrier, you can use force speed to get to the barrels and then phase walk to get right back under the boss, which means you won't be spending much time having to run around and get the barrels when you could be spending that time DPSing. In PvP, there are a lot of uses for phase walk, and its best use really varies depending on the warzone. In Voidstar, you can place it near one of the doors, then go help fight at the other door, and as soon as your teammate calls out for help, you hit phase walk, and bam, you're right back where you need to be to help defend that first door. In Alderaan, I love to use it on that little ledge at mid, right before you hop down to one of the side nodes, because if the person guarding the node calls out for help, you can simply put down phase walk, hop down, help defend, and as soon as the danger has passed, you get back in range of your phase walk, hit it again, and instead of having to run all the way back around to mid, you'll be right back up on that ledge, and it can shave a good 10 seconds off your travel time that way. In arenas, phase walk is a really good escape when your health gets low, so make sure to put it down somewhere safe before the fighting begins. It's good to put it somewhere where your opponents are not likely to see it, but still within 60 meters of wherever the fighting is likely to be. It does take a little bit of experience to find some good spots, so be sure to keep an eye out for rocks, containers, huts, pretty much anything else that will block line of sight between the enemy team and your phasewalk location. Maybe if I have some time later on, I'll even add a section to the end of the video where I can show you where I like to put mine. That's what she. Anyway, to activate Phase Walk, all you have to do is use the ability a second time, and you can do that while stunned. You can do that pretty much any time, because you're not technically using the ability again. You are simply using the buff that you received when you first activated the ability. Also, if you lay your Phase Walk down at a location you don't like as much, and you change your mind, you can always right-click off the Phase Walk buff, and that way it won't go on cooldown, and you can lay it down in a new location. So let's say I think my opponents are going to come at us in an arena. I lay on my Phase Walk somewhere near our start location, and next thing I know, my teammates go charging in towards the enemy. In that case, I can run in a bit closer, I can right-click off the buff, and I can lay phase walk down in a location closer to where the fight is likely to be. Note that phase walk will only get reset in an arena when you die, not when the round ends, so unless you died in the previous round, you won't have to lay phase walk down a second time when the next round starts. Of course, if when that round starts you do want to put it in a different location, you can always click off the buff, as we just discussed. So now we're going to take a few minutes and go through the discipline tree itself, just so you can get a general feel for which abilities are the most important in the rotation and how they all kind of relate to one another. At level 10, we get Force and Balance, which as I mentioned before is one of our cornerstone abilities. Then at level 12, we get Mental Potency, which will reduce the cost of Force and Balance by 20 points. That's nice because up until that point it cost 50 Force, which is half our Force pool, and now it'll cost only 30, which is less than a third. At level 16, we get Force Focus, which slightly increases the damage done by Force Breach, one of our dots. And at level 20, we get our first really important passive ability, Force Strike. So I'll read that to you real quickly. Melee attacks that strike a target affected by your Force Technique's Force Breach effect finish the cooldown on Mindcrush and Vanquish, and make your next Mindcrush or Vanquish activate instantly and consume no Force. This effect cannot occur more than once every 9 seconds. So what that basically means is when you put your Force Breach on a target and then strike them with any melee ability, it doesn't matter which one, as long as it actually lands, we are going to use Double Strike, you get a proc, and you can see Vanquish glowing there because of the proc, and there it is, Force Strike, and that means when you activate it, it's now instant instead of having the cast time, and it costs no Force. There is a 9-second internal cooldown as the ability described, so I'll demonstrate that real quick. Let's put on Force Breach, hit a melee attack, there's the proc, I'll use the proc, and now when I strike him, I won't get the proc again because the internal cooldown is still ticking. So it'll expire in 1 second, and here we go. And now it's back up again because the internal cooldown has expired. Like all internal cooldowns, that can be reduced with Alacrity, so Alacrity will not screw up your rotation, it'll just make it faster. Next, level 24, we get Mind and Body, which is a nice defensive boost. It'll reduce the damage we take from all periodic effects, in other words, enemy dots, by 15%. Obviously, that's really nice in PvP because there are a lot of Serenity Shadows and Balanced Sages running around these days. In addition, this is the ability that gives your Mass Mind Control the damage reduction. It's 30% for 6 seconds, which means not only will Mass Mind Control decrease the damage your teammates are taking, it'll also decrease the damage that you're taking for those 6 seconds. At level 26, we get Severed Force, which is our second major dot, which we discussed in the last section. Then at level 28, we get Prolific Justice, which is probably the most powerful passive ability that we get. So I'll start by reading that to you because it's a little bit complicated, and then I'll do a demonstration. Force Imbalance spreads your periodic Force Breach and Severed Force effects to the targets it damages, as long as it damages targets already affected by your Force Breach and Severed Force. In addition, Force Imbalance overwhelms its targets for 45 seconds. Overwhelmed targets take 10% more damage from area attacks. So the second part is the easy to understand part. Basically means if you hit anybody with Force Imbalance, all future Force Imbalances or Whirling Blows or AoEs from any of your teammates will now do 10% more damage as long as that debuff is active. It's the first part that's a little more complicated and a little more difficult to demonstrate. What it basically means is whenever you hit a target affected by either or both of your dots, whichever dots are ticking on them will be spread to any other target that is also hit by that same Force Imbalance. Unfortunately, the dummies on the ship are too far away to demonstrate that, and because Bioware sucks, you cannot put a dummy anywhere in your stronghold, so we're going to head on over to Tatooine, where some friends are going to help me demonstrate that passive ability to you. So I'm going to demonstrate dot spreading under three different scenarios. In the first scenario, I'll put a single dot, in this case Force Breach, on one target, and then hit all three targets with the same Force Imbalance, which means they will now all have Force Breach ticking on them. And you can see it ticking right there. In the second scenario, I'm going to be putting two dots on them, Sever Force and Force Breach, and then once again, when I cast Force Imbalance, that should spread both dots to both of the other two targets as well. And there you can see them ticking on Red, still on Redrit, and on Ben as well. And in the third scenario, I'm going to place one dot, Sever Force, on one target, the other dot, Force Breach, on a second target, and then hit all three of them with Force Imbalance in order to spread the dots between all the targets. And as you can now see, all three targets have both Force Breach and Sever Force ticking on them. As you've also probably noticed, when a dot is inflicted via dot spreading, it still gets the full 18-second duration, and not just however much time was remaining on the dot ticking on the original target. So as you can imagine, dot spreading is a great source of AoE damage in both PvE and PvP. And here we are, back on my ship to go through the rest of the discipline. At level 32, we get Rebounding Force, which makes Sever Force deal a bit more damage, and Force Technique now restores a bit of force to us as well. At level 36, we get Force Suppression, which adds yet another bonus onto Force Imbalance. From now on, whenever we hit a target with Force Imbalance, it will get a debuff called Force Suppression. And that means anytime a target with Force Suppression takes damage from one of our dots, it uses up one of those 15 stacks and increases the damage done by that dot or from that tick by 10%. At level 40, we get Drain Thoughts, which is just a nice general 10% bonus to all of our periodic abilities, and at level 41, we get Serenity Strike. Then at level 44, we get Adjudication, which increases the critical strike damage by Double Strike, Spinning Strike, and Serenity Strike by 30%, and reduces the force cost of Spinning Strike by 3 points as well. That's really nice because those are three of our main melee abilities, and it means that critical chance from both willpower and crit is a little more important for Serenity than it is for most other DPS disciplines. At level 48, we get our third major rotational passive, and that is called Crushed Spirit. Your damaging periodic effects have a 30% chance to trigger Crushed Spirit, which finishes the cooldown of Spinning Strike and makes your next Spinning Strike usable on a target with any health level. This effect cannot occur more than once every 15 seconds. So what that basically means is whenever your dots are ticking on a target, they have a small chance with every tick to give you a buff, and let's wait for it to happen. Hopefully it'll happen soon. There it is. You can see we now have Crushed Spirit, and our Spinning Strike is glowing, which means we can now use Spinning Strike on the Operations Dummy, even though it has way above 30% health. Normally, there we just got it again. Normally, as you can recall, you can only use Spinning Strike on targets with 30% of their maximum HP or less. Then at level 52, we get Psychic Absorption, which increases a lot of our self-heals. It doubles the self-healing from Force Imbalance and Serenity Strike, and also gives a self-healing component to all of our dot effects. That self-healing component, as I mentioned earlier, is going to be reduced for 25% to 10% in an upcoming patch, so it won't be as significant, but it's still a nice bonus to have. At level 56, we get Mind Quell, which increases the damage from Serenity Strike, Mind Crush, and Vanquish. Once again, that's getting nerfed in the upcoming patch, and it will still affect Mind Crush and Vanquish, in other words, just Vanquish, but it will no longer affect Serenity Strike. At level 57, we get Vanquish, which of course replaces Mind Crush, which you will never ever use again. And then at level 59, we get Aching Mind, which means that Force Imbalance, Vanquish, and all of our dots deal 15% more damage to any target under 30% health. In other words, Serenity Shadows will do a lot more damage to any target that's below 30%, making us a lot more powerful against low health targets and any operations boss that is in execute range. So now that we've gone through all the bonuses that come automatically from the discipline, let's go over the additional bonuses that you can choose using your utility points. I'll start by going through all of them and briefly describing them, and then I'll give you my personal recommendations for PvE and PvP. Remember that you can only spend up to 7 points at any given time, and that you have to choose at least 3 points in the first tier to unlock the Masterful tier, and at least 5 points in the first 2 tiers to unlock the Heroic tier. First up, we have Celerity, which reduces the cooldown of Mind Snap by 2 seconds, Force of Will by 30 seconds, and Force Speed by 5 seconds. Mind Snap is your Interrupt, Force of Will is your CC Breaker, and Force Speed is your Zoom Zoom, so all of those are really nice to have in PvP, and the Force Speed component can be nice in PvE as well. Pinning Resolve reduces the cooldown of Force Stun by 10 seconds. It also will cause your Force Lift to additionally stun up to 2 standard or weak targets that are near your primary target. The second part is really only useful in PvE while you're leveling, because most targets in Ops are not standard or weak, except a couple trash pulls maybe, and even then it's not worth taking a utility just for that. The first part, though, on the Force Stun is nice, because Hard Stuns are very important in PvP, especially in arenas. Mental Defense reduces all damage taken while stunned by 30%. That's great in PvE and also in a couple situational boss fights, because in PvE, obviously, if somebody's going to burst you down, there's a good chance they're going to stun you beforehand. Misdirection increases movement speed by 15% and the effective stealth level by 5. The stealth level is a nice bonus for you, even though you don't use stealth quite as much as infiltration does, but the movement speed increase is great for a melee class to help you stay in range of your targets. Lambast will increase the damage done by Whirling Blow by 25%. You don't use Whirling Blow too much, except maybe in regular war zones, so it's a nice bonus, but there are other better utilities out there. Shadowy Veil is a really wordy ability, but basically what it means is your armor rating is increased by 30%. That's nice defensively, but once again, there are better abilities to choose from. And then finishing up the first tier, we have Force Weak, which makes your Force Wave unbalance the target, immobilizing them for 5 seconds. That immobilizing effect will break from any direct damage taken after the first 2 seconds. Because dots are not a direct damage attack, they will not break that effect, so that's a really nice thing to have to peel. Obviously, Force Wave isn't something that you'll use as much when people are attacking you, but it's something that's really nice to have to help your healer stay alive a couple seconds longer than they otherwise would. In Masterful, we have Mind Over Matter, which increases the duration of Resilience by 2 seconds and Force Speed by 0.5 seconds. Both Resilience and Force Speed are abilities you'll use a lot in PvE and PvP, so that can be a really nice choice. Subduing Techniques increases the duration of Force Slow and reduces its cooldown by 6 seconds. Force Slow you use sometime in PvE, but just reducing the cooldown by 6 seconds and increasing the duration isn't really all that great. Fade reduces the cooldown of Blackout by 15 seconds and Force Click by 30 seconds. That's something that's really nice to have as infiltration, but isn't quite as great as Serenity. Nerve Wracking means that targets controlled by your Spinning Kick or Force Stun take 5% more damage from all sources. You don't obviously have Spinning Kick, so anyone affected by your Force Stun takes 5% more damage. That's nice to have in PvP, but I think there are better choices out there. Egress is a really good ability. It makes Force Speed give you immunity to all movement pairing effects and also purges all movement pairing effects when you use Force Speed. In other words, all roots and slows. That can be really nice to have because there are a lot of roots and slows in PvE these days. Snapped Mind means that when damage breaks a mind maze prematurely, the target will suffer from a zap mind, reducing the damage they deal by 25% for 10 seconds. That's probably not worth choosing simply because you don't want to be breaking any target affected by your mind maze. And even if you do, 25% for 10 seconds isn't all that huge. Force Harmonics reduces the cooldown of Force Wave by a couple seconds, and also gives Force Potency an additional charge. That's really nice to have because it is the only ability here which will directly increase your damage. But again, there are a lot of more useful utilities for PvP, so I would only take Force Harmonics in PvE. As far as heroics go, we have Humming Strike. When a target recovers from being stunned by your spinning kick or Force Stun, for us it's just Force Stun, its movement speed is slowed by 90% for the following 3 seconds. Because Force Stun is only something we use about once a minute, it's probably not worth spending one of your heroic points on that. Shadow Shelter increases all healing received by 3% and also means that your Phase Walk will give a buff to any healer standing in it. That's great to have for PvE and you should always take it, but in PvP there are better heroic abilities. Containment means your Force Lift will activate instantly, which isn't that much faster than it otherwise would because it means 2 seconds is now only 1.5 seconds. However, because it's instant, you can now use it on the move and at a moment's notice, which is a really nice thing to have. In addition, if it breaks early from damage, the target is stunned for an additional 2 seconds, and we talked a little bit about that during the ability section. This is something that's definitely worth considering in PvE because having an instant 8-second CC is amazing, and that additional 2 seconds of stun if you break it early by accident is just a nice bonus on top of the cake. Sturdiness means that while deflection is active, you are totally immune to stun, sleep, lift, or incapacitating effects. Obviously, that doesn't affect things like roots and slows and knockbacks, but being completely immune to stuns during those entire 12 seconds can be huge in PvP, so that's definitely something you want to always consider. Martial Prowess it gives a bonus to your force pool, immobilizing the target. It also gives an immobilize to Serenity Strike and Low Slash. You don't get Low Slash, obviously. It's nice to have because obviously immobilizing a target means it's easier for you to stay in melee range, but compared to some of these other abilities, I wouldn't give it serious consideration. Cloak of Resilience is nice. It gives you 2 seconds of resilience, and those 2 seconds are affected by the bonus from Mind Over Matter, so it can be 4 seconds in total. That's really nice to consider in PvP because one of the big things that's going to pull you back into stealth once you activate your Force Cloak is having a sticky grenade or an assault plastique on you from a Vanguard or having a dot ticking on you from one of your opponents. So having the automatic resilience every time you cloak out means you can use resilience during the fight as a defensive cooldown and not have to save it to purge all your dots in case you need to cloak out later in the fight. And last but not least, we have Motion Control, which makes Force Cloak increase your movement speed while it's active, helping you to get away from the combat. And it also gives a nice little bonus to Force Slow, which is nice, but again, there are better utilities out there. So for PvE, I would take Celerity for the Force Speed reduced cooldown, Misdirection to help you stay in range of the boss because of the speed boost, and then depending on the boss fight, either Lambast or Shadowy Veil. On boss fights that have a lot of adds, you'll be attacking with Whirling Blow, take Lambast for the damage boost. On any other boss where you'll be on the same target the entire time, just take Shadowy Veil for the armor increase. From the second tier, I would take Mind Over Matter because extra resilience is always nice, and Force Harmonics because the extra charge of Force Potency will directly increase your DPS. From the last tier, you definitely want Shadow Shelter because not only does it increase the healing you receive, it'll increase the healing your healers do to all of the people in your group. And the last point is pretty much up for grabs. You can choose the immunity to stuns with deflection up, which could be nice on a fight such as the final fight of Ravagers. You could choose whichever one you didn't choose in the first tier between Lambast and Shadowy Veil. You could choose to have extra movement speed with Force Cloak. It really all comes down to personal preference at that point. In PvP, I would choose Celerity for all those nice reduced cooldowns, Mental Defense for the reduced damage taken while stunned, and Misdirection for the increased movement speed. You can also strongly consider Force Wake, especially in ranked arenas, because it'll help you peel for your healers and your teammates. Or Pinning Resolve because having the reduced Force Stun is always really nice. In unranked war zones, especially 8v8s, Lambast can also be really nice to have. From the second tier, I would choose Mind Over Matter because resilience and Force Speed are two of your most important abilities. And personally, I like to take Egress because a lot of times people will try to root you or slow you to keep you away from their healers or their teammates. And using that is really effective to stay in range and to keep line of sight on your target. Then when it comes to heroic, there's three amazing heroic abilities, and it is really hard to just choose two of them. Containment is amazing, as I said before, because that insta-lift is just so yummy when you can turn stunned opponent for 8 seconds, and if they don't have their CC breakup or aren't willing to waste it, they're just entirely out of the battle for 8 seconds. That's amazing, and it's super amazing in any fight that does not have both a tank and a healer in it. Sturdiness is, again, super amazing because being immune to all stuns for 12 seconds means you can stand there and burst on your opponents, and it drastically decreases the amount of things that their teammates can do to peel. And having Cloak of Resilience is great because you can use your resilience as a defensive cooldown, as I said before, and not have to save it for when you're going to cloak out with Force Cloak. And if you do burn your resilience, then you don't have to worry about being pulled back into combat immediately by a dot ticking on you or something like a sticky grenade. Honestly, I alternate, at least in ranked, between any two of these three. I love Force Lift, I love Deflection, and I love Cloak of Resilience. It's important to keep using Deflection at least half of the time, but the nice thing about it is that as long as you do use it sometimes, even if you don't use it all the time, people are, for the most part, at least smart people, are going to not want to waste their Hardstun on you or a CC on you when you have Deflection, because chances are, better than not, it's not going to affect you. So, honestly, depending on how I'm feeling that day, I switch between these two, and if you do that, the thing to remember is which ones you have, because you don't want to be trying to use an instant Force Lift on the move and then only to realize you need to cast it, and you don't want to be cloaking out with dots on you only to have it pull you back into combat because you thought you had resilience up. And actually, deflection doesn't really matter because even if you pop it and don't have the immunity, somebody probably is not going to stun you. So honestly, for ranked, I tend to use containment 90% of the time and then just alternate between the other two. So by this point, you should have a pretty good idea of what our abilities are and how they all work together. Now let's go over the rotation itself. Obviously, this section is more oriented towards PvE than PvP, because in PvP, your targets have a lot less health, there are more of them, and you'll be target swapping a lot more often. But it should still give you a pretty good foundation to work from. So this rotation is based around putting up good numbers in the dummy, and obviously in boss fights there are plenty of other things you need to consider, such as mechanics, adds, DPS downtime, trying to stay alive. But on the whole, this is the rotation you should be keeping up on the boss as much as you possibly can. Now, there are a few different varieties to the strategy rotation, and the two big ones are a priority-based system, which is a lot easier to keep track of, but means you'll sometimes have to delay important abilities, and a rotational system, which is more difficult to manage, but puts up slightly higher numbers. Personally, I like to use a hybrid between the two, which is still pretty easy to keep track of, and will only ever really delay Serenity Strike, which really won't make much of a difference in DPS, especially after it gets nerfed in the next patch. All of our abilities are instant, which means we can use an ability about once every 1.5 seconds, the default length of the global cooldown. Our dots, as you remember, last for 18 seconds each, which makes our rotation 18 seconds, or 12 global cooldowns long. So what I'm going to do is put 12 boxes up on the screen, each one representing one move in that 18-second period. Then I'm going to duplicate these rows so that you can see how the rotation will vary as the fight goes on. Don't worry if this all looks like it's a lot to keep track of. All you have to do is master the initial 18-second rotation, and the rest will flow naturally from there. So first we're going to add in our dots, since those are the reason the rotation is 18 seconds long in the first place. In the priority-based method, you tend to keep your dots right next to each other, and in the more complicated rotation system, you keep three GCDs in between them to allow room for other abilities to slide in. However, in our system, we're only going to keep one GCD in between them, leaving just enough space for our most important abilities to slip through, so that we don't lose DPS by delaying them while we reapply one of our dots. Next, we'll add in Vanquish, which has a 9-second internal cooldown on the proc, meaning that you can use it twice per rotation. For the most part, you'll be using it on the 6th spot and 12th spot in the rotation. In other words, two GCDs after you apply your dots, and then right before you're ready to reapply them again. I find this especially helpful because that second Vanquish proc becomes a nice little reminder of when it's time to reapply both of your dots. Next, we'll add in Force Imbalance, which has a 15-second cooldown, meaning it will move up two spots each time we do the rotation. Whenever Force Imbalance and the proc Vanquish are up at the same time, always prioritize Force Imbalance. This is because the internal cooldown on Vanquish starts when you get the proc, and not when you use it, so you can delay Vanquish by up to two GCDs without losing any DPS. It does have a 6-second dot though, so if you wait any longer than that, you risk clipping it and losing DPS. That's basically the rotation. The rest of these spots we're going to fill in with our melee abilities, so I'm just going to put an M in those boxes for melee, because which melee ability you use at any given time really depends on a number of factors. Whenever it's time to use a melee ability, Serenity Strike is always your first priority if it's available. Serenity Strike has a flat out 12-second cooldown and also triggers part of your set bonus, so it's beneficial to use it as much as possible. If Serenity Strike isn't up, Spinning Strike gets second priority. Remember that the proc that allows you to use Spinning Strike is slightly random, so you can't entirely predict when you're going to get it. As with Vanquish, it's okay to delay Spinning Strike by a few GCDs because the internal cooldown starts the moment you get the proc, not the moment you use it. Double Strike is our third priority and our standard melee filler. However, if you're getting a little low on force, just use Saber Strike instead. Getting a feel for when to use Double Strike and when to use Saber Strike will take a bit of practice, but as a general rule of thumb, you want to use Double Strike when you have more than half your force pool left, and Saber Strike anytime you have less than that. Basically, if at any time during the fight you don't have enough force to use your next ability, it means you use too many double strikes. Likewise, if you ever have 100% of your force pool, it means you use too many saber strikes. So it is a balancing act, and it's something you will get used to in time. So for now, just try to focus on mastering the rotation itself. Now, the opener is a little different. Once again, there are a lot of variations you can try, but this is the one I personally like best because it puts up good initial numbers and flows very nicely into the rotation we just discussed. On the whole, it looks really similar to the regular 18-second rotation. The only difference is the position of Vanquish. First off, you want to start by hard casting Vanquish, because you won't actually enter combat until the end of the cast. If your tank doesn't normally do a countdown before pulling the boss, tell them to start. After that, you simply want to use Vanquish every time you get the proc. You'll notice this means you'll be using Vanquish one spot earlier than usual, but that's okay, because when you get to this point here, you'll be using Force Imbalance in place of the melee ability that would normally proc your next Vanquish. Because of this, you'll have to use a melee ability afterwards to get that proc, and that puts Vanquish at the spot it's supposed to be in the rotation. All of that may sound complicated, but the great part is that you don't even have to think about it. Just use the initial opener, hard casted Vanquish, Severed Force, Force Imbalance, Force Breach, and the rest will flow naturally from there. Force Imbalance whenever it's up, reapply your dots when you need to, Vanquish onto the proc, and fill up the rest with melee attacks. As far as your offensive cooldowns go, you want to pop Force Potency and your Adrenal right after the initial Vanquish, and then pop Battle Readiness after applying Force Breach. This brings us to the execute phase. In other words, the rotation you'll be using on the boss after they fall below 30% of their health. At this point, you actually want to completely drop the rotation we just discussed and fall to a much simpler priority system. The reason for this is because you can now use Spinning Strike off cooldown without having to wait for the proc. So first priority is Force Imbalance, which now does 15% extra damage thanks to the boost from Aching Mind. After that, prioritize Spinning Strike, followed by Vanquish, Force Breach, Severed Force, and Serenity Strike. Saber Strike will become your primary filler ability because with all of the extra spinning strikes, it'll be more difficult to keep your force pool up during this phase. Now that we've got all that explained, let's do a little demonstration. So except for my offensive cooldowns, I'm going to be clicking on all of my abilities for this parse, just so that you can see which abilities I'm using as I use them. But in an actual fight, you of course want to have all your abilities keybound. That way you can use your main mouse buttons primarily for movement. I'll be using the 500k health module to make things quick. And of course, I'll also be using the armor debuff module, both of which you can buy from your ship droid. I'll show you where that's at. And if you don't have one, you can also just use a friend's and buy one on their ship. There they are, down there at the bottom. They also have modules for 1 million health and 1.5 million, and those are actually a lot more standard, so if you're trying to parse and get a good idea of where your DPS actually is, I would highly recommend using one of them. Let's go back upstairs. And without any further ado, here we go. And that's all there is to it. One last thing I want to mention about parsing is that it's important to never have any downtime between your abilities. And to avoid this, you can actually hit a button for an ability, essentially queuing up that ability, before the previous global cooldown has even expired. So I'll demonstrate that here using Double Strike and Saber Strike. So you can see I use Double Strike, and then before the GCD expires, I hit Saber Strike, and yet it still went off. However, if you do it too quickly, nothing happens. The amount of time before the GCD expires that you have to hit the next ability and have it still actually go off is called the Ability Action Queue Window, and you can find that under Preferences, Controls, Combat, and there it is. You can set that anywhere between 0 seconds and a full second. The default is half a second, but I actually prefer 0.75. Gives you a little bit of extra time, so that's something else you can play around with and see if that might help your DPS any. So next we're going to talk about stats and gearing. So the first thing we're going to go over is Datacrons, and there are 7 types of Datacrons in the game. Strength, Presence, Aim, Cunning, Endurance, Willpower, and Matrix Shards. Of these, the only ones that really matter to you are Strength, Endurance, and Willpower, possibly Presence. Presence buffs your companion's abilities, so if you're somebody who does a lot of dailies, or flashpoints with companions, or leveling, then you might want some presence, but otherwise you probably don't, as it'll be useless to you in war zones and operations. Willpower is very important. You want to make sure you get all of your willpower datacrons because it's a direct increase in damage and also increases your critical chance. Endurance is also very important because having that little bit of extra health might mean the difference between dying and surviving in a boss fight or a war zone. And strength is less important, but it does increase the critical chance of your melee attack slightly, so you should definitely get it. You can see critical chance. You can see there is a component from strength. And do as I say, not as I do, because while I have, I think, all the willpower and most of the endurance datacrons, I am missing a few strength on this character because I am lazy and I hate getting datacrons. The good news is we have phase walk as a shadow, so you're lucky in that regard because some of those jumps are a real pain, and having phase walk means you can try them every 40 seconds instead of having to redo the entire stupid jumping puzzle to get back to where you were before you missed the stupid jump. So, yeah, as a shadow, Datacron shouldn't be too hard to get. Make sure to get all your willpower, strength, and endurance ones, and that's a nice flat-out boost you'll always get. You also want to make sure that you have your companion's affection maxed on at least one of your tunes for all companions. So I'll bring out my companion there, and you can see max affection. You get affection by doing quests and primarily through giving them gifts. Once you have max affection, you get some nice bonuses from that. So you can see Kaizen will give you a bonus to accuracy, 1%. You must have that. It's very, very useful. Therion will give you a bonus to healing received, also very useful. Felix gives you a bonus to max health. Nadia gives you a bonus to surge. And Zenith gives you a bonus to critical hit, all of which you definitely want to have. If you have them on one character, you don't have to have them on all the rest because it will apply across your entire legacy. Having multiple characters or multiple companions across multiple characters max affectioned is nice because it gives you 10 presents per each, but otherwise it's not as vital as long as you have them all maxed on at least one tune. So one of the most important aspects of gearing for both PvE and PvP is your set bonus, and as a DPS shadow, whether you're Infiltration or Serenity, you'll always want the Stalker set bonus, and you can see these pieces here have the Stalker set bonus on them. The set bonus is attached to the armoring of a piece, so if you don't like the looks of the default armor, which you probably won't, you can take that piece, pull out the armoring, put the armoring in any other piece you want, and the new piece will have the set bonus attached to it, so you don't have to worry about using the default PvE gear. You get a set bonus at 2 pieces, 4 pieces, and 6 pieces, and there are 7 pieces in total which contribute to your set bonus: your robe, boots, hands, head, legs, waist, and bracers. So in total you only need 6 of those to get the full set bonus, all 3 parts. When you have 2 of those pieces, you get the first bonus, Ball Lightning and Leeching Strike, or Psychotic Blast and Serenity Strike. Increased damage dealt by 2% for 15 seconds. Cannot occur more than once every 30 seconds. The other abilities listed there are for Infiltration and the Imperial equivalents. So the only one that really matters there is Serenity Strike. So whenever you use Serenity Strike, once every 30 seconds at least, you will receive a 2% DPS bonus, which is pretty nice. At 4 stacks, your next bonus is that it reduces the cooldown of Recklessness or Force Potency by 15 seconds. So it'll go down from 1 minute and 30 seconds, give or take, to about 1:15. And then at 6 pieces, after activating Voltaic Strike and Thrash, or Clairvoyant Strike and Double Strike, your next Assassinate and Maul, or Spinning Strike and Shadow Strike will critically hit. This effect can only occur once every minute. So to narrow that down a bit to the parts that are relevant to you, basically every time you use double strike up to once a minute, your next spinning strike will be a critical hit. And obviously that's pretty good because spinning strike is one of our heaviest hitting abilities, and making a critically hit guaranteed once every minute is a nice little DPS bonus. So none of these are going to be a overwhelming huge DPS increase, but they are nice to have, and they will definitely increase your DPS. So it's always better to have a set bonus piece than a non-set bonus piece if you can get your hands on one. So before we do anything else, go under Preferences, then User Interface, and scroll down to Tooltips, and make sure you have Show Detailed Item Tooltips, Enable Comparative Tooltips, and Enable Stat Summarization and Item Tooltips all selected. This will make it easier to tell exactly where your stats are coming from, and to compare pieces of gear you're wearing against gear offered by the vendors. Now, I'm going to take a minute and go over the basics of stats just for those of you unfamiliar with them. There are three categories of stats, which I like to call primary stats, secondary stats, and tertiary stats. And as a rule, it is a lot easier to exchange stats within their category than it is to exchange them with stats in other categories, especially at a one-to-one ratio. So for example, for shadows, endurance and willpower are our two primary stats, and it's a lot easier to give up a little bit of endurance for a little bit of willpower, or vice versa, than it is to say give up a little bit of endurance and get a little bit of power, which is one of our secondary stats. Power and crit are our, or power and critical rating rather, are our two secondary stats, and surge, alacrity, and accuracy are our three tertiary stats. Each different piece we have provides a different combination of stats and different amounts of them. So, for example, your earpiece, implants, and most of your main set pieces all provide main stat, secondary stats, and tertiary stats. Whereas relics, for example, will provide a lot of main stats, a little bit of secondary stat, which will always be power, and an additional effect besides, and your belt and bracers will only give main stat and secondary stat. You can also see in the breakdown exactly where those stats are coming from. So arm rings only give you main stats, a little bit of both. Mods will give you a lot of main stat and a decent amount of secondary stat as well. And enhancements will give you some endurance, some secondary stat, and some tertiary stats. So what this basically means is all of your 14 pieces of gear will contribute some main stat and some secondary stat, and you get a choice in most pieces of which secondary stat you want. And the tertiary stats will come from your earpiece, your two implants, your main hand offhand, and your five main set pieces. So in other words, you have 10 total pieces of tertiary stats, all of which contribute the exact same amount at the same gear level. And in the next two sections, I'll be going through what the ideal combinations of those stats are for PvE and PvP. So first, let's go over your main stats, endurance and willpower. That's really easy. You always want willpower. Willpower is more important as a DPS than endurance will be because your job is to do as much damage as possible. It's up to your cooldowns and your healers and proper execution of mechanics to make sure you stay alive. So having more health is always nice, and you will get more health as you get higher gear levels automatically. But whenever you have a choice between endurance and willpower, you always want to choose willpower. That means with the arm rings, you want the Resolve arm rings and not the Force Wielder arm rings. For mods, you always want the variety of mods that have no letters in the name, which is, I know, weird to hear. But what I mean by that is for this one, and for example, this is the Advanced Aptitude mod, and there are different varieties of Advanced Aptitude mods. There are 37s, 37As, 37Bs. You always want the 37 without the A or B on the end. The A or B means it's not itemized ideally. As are okay for DPS, Bs are just really horrible for DPS, and you never ever want a B mod in your gear. As are okay to have if you're still working on your gear and trying to get the letterless ones, but when you do get the letterless ones, you want to replace those. A 192 piece that is letterless is the equivalent in terms of DPS as a 198 piece, which is an A mod, but a 198 piece will have more endurance. So for example, I believe it goes up, I believe they're just called 38s, it might be 39s, but a 38 A mod is the same as a 37 mod DPS wise, but it has more endurance, so I would prefer a 38 A mod over a 37 letterless mod. But assuming all else being equal, in other words, if you have two 37 mods, you want to use the letterless one whenever possible, even if it has, say, crit instead of power or the stat that you don't ideally want too much of. As far as secondary stats go, you want to have up to one crit piece and the rest power. Again, this is in an ideal scenario. So if you have a couple 198 crit pieces and some 192 power pieces that you could replace them for, it's better just to stick with the good 198 crit pieces. But if you're looking at the equivalent gear level and you have a choice between, say, 82 power or 82 crit, you probably want 82 power. You want to keep your critical rating below 100 whenever possible. For the tertiary stats, Surge, Alacrity, and Accuracy, it's a little more complicated. And you get those from 10 pieces, as you remember. Your earpiece, your two implants, your main hand, offhand, and then your five big set pieces, because those come from your enhancements, and these are the seven pieces that have enhancements on them. So, in other words, you get them from your earpiece, two implants, and seven enhancements. Each of those pieces contributes the exact same amount of accuracy, alacrity, or surge at the same gear level. So, at 198 level, that's 120 tertiary stat. And you want to have five pieces accuracy, three pieces alacrity, and two pieces surge in PvE. This will give you the maximum DPS with those with that stat combination. Having that amount of accuracy will not get you to 110% force accuracy or 110% melee accuracy, which is what you want to be really close to. You can see there I'm at 99.9, so it's close enough. And you want to use augments to get the rest of the way there. So augment-wise, you want to use just enough accuracy pieces to get as close as you can to 100% melee accuracy, which will put you at 110% force accuracy without going over. It's okay to go a little bit over, it's okay to be a little bit under, but you don't want to be too far in either direction, because that's a waste of stats. Once you have enough accuracy from your augments, you want to use the rest of your augments as willpower augments. Power ones are also okay, but willpower has a very slight edge. So you can see there that these are called Advanced Resolve Augments 36. You can make those if you have a Synthweaver and the appropriate slicing materials, or you can buy them off the GTN. They usually go for a little over 100k a piece on most servers. And that's it for PvE. On one final note, you may have noticed when I was hovering over some of my gear pieces that I have Force Master set bonuses on a lot of my gear. You're probably thinking, what the hell? Did you lie to me? Should I be using Force Master? No, you should be using Stalker. The reason I have Force Master's gear is because I use a lot of pieces of legacy gear just to send them between my Sage and Shadow and Assassin and Sorcerer easily. So for that reason, I have the Force Master set bonus on them. So my Sage, which is my main hard mode tune, gets the most benefit out of them. But one day I would definitely like to make a separate gear set for my Shadow, and in that case, I will definitely be using the Stalker set bonus because that is the only one that really has any use for a Shadow. And unless you are doing the exact same thing I am, you should definitely be prioritizing the Stalker set bonus pieces. So next, we're going to go over PvP gear, and PvP gear is differentiated from PvE gear by a stat called Expertise, and you can see that every piece of PvP gear has a good amount of expertise on it. In a full set of PvP gear, no matter what tier it is, you'll have 20,018 expertise, and that gives you a boost to damage done, a reduction to damage received, and a boost to healing done while fighting other players. So whenever you are in a PvP situation, whether it's war zones, arenas, or even open world, a piece of PvP gear will always be more valuable to you than a piece of PvE gear. The one thing you never want to do is mix and match inserts from PvE and PvP. So you either want to be wearing a piece of gear that has a full set of PvE inserts, in other words, no expertise, or you want a full set of PvP inserts in that piece of gear so that you have the max expertise from it. Otherwise, the bolster system will not bolster you correctly. And this only applies to each specific piece of gear. So you don't want to have a chest piece that has half PvE inserts and half PvP inserts, but it's okay to have a chest piece that has all PvE inserts and a set of gloves that has all PvP inserts. So when you first get into war zones, you'll probably be wearing your default set of PvE gear, and that's okay because the only way to get gear is by doing war zones. So when you go in, you will get bolstered and you will get some expertise. That way you're not totally destroyed by people wearing full PvP gear. But as soon as possible, you want to gather those war zone commendations from winning war zones or from losing war zones, but you get less from losing, and from the weeklies and dailies associated with PvP, and spend those at this vendor here, Mr. Yalen Keljo. And he will sell you exhumed gear, which is 168s. And as before, you want to be buying the Stalker's gear set. Once you have a full set of Stalker's gear, you can turn in these pieces of gear along with your ranked commendations and use those to buy ranked PvP gear, which is the second tier of gear, currently called Dark Reaver, and this is 174 gear. And you can see the Stalker's gear there, and you can see it requires a large amount of ranked commendations as well as the corresponding exhumed piece. Now, when you get the exhumed piece, I highly recommend you take out all the inserts from it and put it in a piece of gear which you like the looks of. That way you can turn in the token later on for the better piece and not lose all of your mods in the process. It's also very important to augment your gear because that'll give you a nice big stat boost. And you want to augment the gear pieces that you like the looks of. That way, you're not augmenting your exhumed gear and having to turn in those augmented pieces when you buy the next set of gear. You could debate over whether it's worth augmenting your exhumed earpiece implants and relics, or whether it's worth waiting for the Dark Reaver pieces, and that pretty much depends on your financial situation in game and whether you plan on doing ranked. If you plan on doing ranked PvP, make sure you don't enter without at least a full set of exhumed gear, and make sure that exhumed gear is augmented, because otherwise you will get slaughtered and be a liability to your team. So if you don't have 20,000 AT expertise, and if all 14 of these pieces are not augmented, don't even think about stepping into ranked. Once you do have your full set of exhumed gear and they're all augmented, if this is the route you choose to go, then you can do ranked war zones, either solo or group, and that'll be a faster way to get ranked wars and commendations. Otherwise, you can simply get ranked wars and commendations by doing the daily and weekly, and by turning in regular war zone commendations for ranked commendations at a 3-to-1 ratio. And you can see those there. Cost 30 wars and commendations for 10 ranked wars of commendations. And remember, you can also hit shift to choose multiple ones at a time, so you're not sitting there spam clicking all day long. Once you have either a full set of exhumed gear or a full set of Dark Reaver gear, this is another thing that's up to personal preference, you can begin min-maxing your gear, because as with PvE, the default set of gear you buy will not have the best armorings, mods, and inserts necessarily for your class. So I'm going to go through each set of stats, primary, secondary, and tertiary, and tell you what you should be aiming for in PvP to get the maximum amount of damage out of your character. So primary stats are endurance and willpower, and you always want to prioritize willpower over endurance, even though endurance has a good amount of use in PvP because staying alive is obviously important. It's more important that you do damage and kill your enemy, because nothing will keep you alive longer than making your enemy be dead, because dead enemies obviously do zero damage. So it's more important to have willpower than it is to have endurance. When it comes to power and crit, in PvP you always want to have power. Every point of power is always more useful than a point of crit. Crit isn't bad to have. If you have some of it, that's okay. If you're comparing a 174 crit piece versus a 168 power piece, go for the 174 crit piece. But all else being equal, you want to prioritize power over crit whenever possible. As far as tertiary stats go, alacrity, surge, and accuracy, you probably don't want any accuracy. You could make an argument in its favor, but because force attacks don't miss in PvP, in other words, Sever Force, Force Breach, Vanquish, and Force Imbalance, which are your heavy hitters, investing points in accuracy is really only going to benefit half of your abilities, which makes it a lot less useful. For Surge and Alacrity, I would try to make them as equal as possible. I run 5 pieces of each, 5 pieces of Surge and 5 pieces of Alacrity. If you do choose to lean in one direction, I would lean slightly in the direction of Alacrity, which I know is unintuitive because for the longest time in this game, Alacrity was pretty much a useless stat. At 3.0, that changed, and Alacrity is now super useful because it speeds up your rotation drastically. And pretty much a percentage of alacrity will be the equivalent percentage of increase in DPS, which means alacrity is very powerful. But some surge is still good to have as well, because having instant heavy hitting abilities can really be useful in PvP. As far as augments go, you want to have 14 willpower augments, because as I said before, accuracy is pretty much useless for Serenity, and willpower is slightly better than power. If you do have power augments, if say you have some lying in your bank, or say you have a arms tech but not a synthweaver, and it's easier for you to get power augments, you can use those. They're pretty much just as good as willpower, but if you're really trying to win min-max, you want to go with willpower augments. So in a full min-max set of 174 gear, you should have all 174 letterless mods, in other words, ones that have X on the end and not AX or BX, and those will have the high power. So you should have a full set of Aptitude Mod 33Xs, in other words. For enhancements, you want them to all have power on them, and you want half of them to have alacrity and half of them to have surge. And when I say enhancements, I'm also including earpieces and implants in that. When it comes to min-maxing, this is the vendor that sells the mods you want. So if you're min-maxing with 168 gear, you want Advanced Aptitude Mods 31Xs. And when you're min-maxing with 174 gear, you want Advanced Aptitude Mods 33Xs, and for enhancements, you want to go to this nice lady, Lieutenant Volin, and she will sell you the enhancements you need, which are Advanced Adept Enhancement 33X for Surge, and Advanced Quick Savant Enhancement 33X for Alacrity. If you do choose to min-max enhancements at the 168 gear level, then you'll have to go over to this guy, and he sells the equivalent enhancements for exhumed gear. So there's the Adept 31 for Surge, and the Quick Savant 31 for Alacrity. And that's basically all there is to gearing for a Serenity Shadow in PvP. And that brings us to the end of our guide. So thank you all very much for watching. I hope this proved helpful, and I hope it'll help you enjoy your shadow more in both PvE and PvP. There are plenty of videos of me using Liavara in both Operations and Warzones up on my YouTube channel, so I'll have links to some of those on the screen right now. And if you're interested in seeing some of these suggestions and strategies in action, be sure to check those out. Thanks for watching, subscribe if you enjoyed, and keep an eye out for the rest of my guides, which will hopefully be coming to this channel very soon. Take care, and may the Force be with you.